I actually think it's a look at journalism primarily.
Good,
just like a great film that I've referenced as an inspiration, which was the Noam Chomsky film Manufacturing Consent.
Hello, Canada. Very honored to be here with filmmaker Yung Chang and your TIFF premiere of This Is Not a Movie. Congratulations.
Thank you so much. It's so great to be... Wow, like I remember in 2007, you were helping to put the word out for Up the Yangtze, and now comes back around. It's wonderful. It's good to see you again.
You as well. Yeah.
So thanks for having me.
Thank you. This is a feature film about legendary iconoclast, one of the most perhaps prolific, perhaps divisive foreign correspondents, journalists, columnists of our time, Robert Fisk. Tell us about your film, and then I'm going to grill you with questions.
In the nutshell, let's see. The movie's called, well, as you can see, This Is Not a Movie. It's about this. I actually think it's a look at journalism primarily through the eyes of this I would call him an iconoclast more than anything. Someone who's sort of redefined journalism through his lifetime, over 40 years of experience, and I wanted to make a film about journalism specifically to address the world we live in today, and where our interaction with media has completely been flipped. And I felt like someone looking through the eyes of someone like Robert could be instructive in a way. Not necessarily, I don't want it to be didactic. I want the audience to engage with the film critically and with the ideas he presents about what journalism is. Essentially, this movie is a portrait of Robert Fisk, but it's also an essay. It's an essay on how to report the truth. I like the subheading, the politics of truth, and I think right now, with so much being, you know, with journalism and journalists being, you know, vilified and questioned, and that someone like himself, like Robert, can step up and just sort of, we can watch him and learn a little bit, you know, and engage with him.
When I saw this film, going into it, first it said this is not a movie. Mm-hmm. I was curious about the title, mm-hmm. which we later learn about. But I thought, because it's just like what you said, and perhaps audiences will have an idea in their mind of what they're gonna see. I thought it would more be a look at the fake news land we live in now, and the discourse around that, some of the controversy around that. This is an intimate portrait into one journalist's life. It doesn't go as much into the bigger picture right now, yet it speaks, like you said, so much to what's happening today. But it almost does the reverse and goes into a land of a notepad and paper, frontline, no GPS. We see scenes where he's hearing now in a current time the blasts of shells, explosions, and from his years on the front ground is able to identify that came from there. That's an explosion, not a gun. Oh, wait, there's the firing back. I mean, that those set of use of your five senses, six senses to report is something you don't hear enough about anymore. And perhaps, do you think after being part of this and traveling with him and being with him that will journalists ever have that experience again? What do you think about that?
Well, that's a great, yeah. No, so I think, well, I mean, I do think Robert Fisk is sort of part of that lost generation of reporters who do the thing which is like, you know, long form. I think the term bandied around now is slow journalism, you know, just like the slow food movement or slow cinema. You have slow journalism, which is just long form. It can be it's not, you know, captioned tweets or, you know, to fill in the 24-hour news cycle. This is long form journalism. It, you know, someone like Robert will hit the ground, have a sort of a hypothesis of what he wants to look into, whether it be the Saudi you know, Saudi Arabian arms deal with you know, investigating the manufacturing of arms, and we go to, in the film we go to Bosnia following this story where Robert found manuals in Aleppo on the side of from ISIS. These Bosnian arms manuals were signed by somebody at an arms factory in Bosnia. So we actually got on a plane and we went to Bosnia, from Beirut to Bosnia, from Aleppo to Beirut to Bosnia. And Robert goes knocking on the door of this manager who signed off on the arms shipment. And then he goes sniffing to find out who actually bought the arms, and we discovered that it was Saudi Arabia. So, you know, that kind of long-form journalism, I think, is really interesting. It's not something that I think everyone is doing, I think there are certainly, I mean, he's not the only guy doing this kind of long-form reporting, but I think what is interesting through Robert's eyes is sort of what I learned is this idea of how to work as a journalist today, what binds us to the truth, and how do we how can we navigate these questions of what is real and what is fake? And I think through someone like Robert is a pretty good example. What I learned over my time following him, you know, as myself, I took the position of being the eyewitness reporter, you know, following Robert. Because I came in knowing all the vitriol around him, you know, being controversial, and I realized, you know what, Robert is his integrity as his journalistic integrity has been his guide for the past 40 years, you know, since he started when he was 20, in his early 20s, and the fact that he defines journalism in two ways, you know, to report on the side of those who suffer and to challenge and question authority, especially when it comes, governments and authority, especially when it comes to, you know, if these governments are bringing us into war. And so I think journalism is the, like, this overall kind of look through Robert's eyes. I realized I didn't need to bring in other voices. I didn't need to, you know, it wasn't the talking heads film interviewing all sorts of people, pro, con, Fisk, and then what is journalism? No, I felt like we could just anchor ourselves through the voice of this guy, just like a great film that I've referenced as an inspiration, which was the Noam Chomsky film Manufacturing Consent from back in the day, Mark Akbar and Peter Wintonik, the great Peter Wintonik, who died not so long ago and produced my film China Heavyweight. Anyway, it was sort of like in the Noam Chomsky film. It's Noam Chomsky, you know, primarily, and it's his ideas, and the way that film is structured is one that where you can have that banter with the movie. You can watch him and not necessarily like him. You can question him. That was my intention as well with this film. Like, you know, we follow a bunch of observational. It's observational on one level in the present day. We're following Robert. We're watching how he works. There's moments of maybe sometimes awkwardness, and I left that in purposely. You know, when he gets the photo taken at the lecture, at the high school lecture he gives to the Beirut Lebanese students. You know, he's kind of you see how he's sort of not comfortable in the public eye, and then later when he. With the UN soldier, or the peacekeeper, he mentions, you know, the question of PTSD and how he never had PTSD. I mean, I want to leave that open because I do think he's of another generation. We should allow ourselves to be able to question him, but also disagree or agree. And that was the point of this, the structure of the film. And I ramble. I'm sorry.
It was incredible. That was something I really wanted to get to, because your role isn't that unlike his, but you are, as you said, an eyewitness. And so when you're spending that much time observing, I think there's a part in the movie where he says, people will say to him, oh, you haven't spent enough time in the Middle East. You don't have the grounding to be able to report on the facts properly. That's not the exact quote, but something like that. Yeah, and then if you spent too much time there, your perspective is skewed. You perhaps take things out of context mm-hmm. or too much context mm-hmm. or mm-hmm. So did you find that going into the slow doc movement mm-hmm. with him, did that alter your perception of him? How did you stay true to your vision and your integrity as the documentary filmmaker sure. when obviously you're going to see things, uncover things. Wow, we just discovered this. Mm-hmm. That must have been exciting being on the front lines, discovering and uncovering truths. Yeah. But where would you keep that integrity and keep your cool? And, you know, conversely, there's times where he does speak about not being emotionally attached. Mm-hmm. But does that cut us off from feeling? There are some great journalists and correspondents from the front lines who mm. speak about that they're led by their hearts mm. and that it is the emotion that captivates them to find the human, to tell the human story. Mm-hmm. So not necessarily a question, but what was your experience drawing your own lines mm. for that?
Yeah, no, that's great. I mean, I think going into it, I mean, I consider myself a filmmaker. I don't necessarily consider myself a journalist. I never studied journalism. You know, I hold in my filmmaking certain rules of, you know, ethical rules of how I want to make my films. For this movie, it was sort of like shedding a lot of these approaches that I had from my previous movies that were observational. It was sort of like, you know, we came in with sort of the approach like, this is a film about journalistic integrity. It's a film about journalism. I'm not going to set up shots in terms of like set the shot up and have Robert walk through something. You know, we're chasing the story just and with him through it. So that was something that we did to sort of define the immediacy of the story. Part of the story is built in this present day line, right? We're following Robert, 74 years old. He's still working. He's still, you know, doing his thing. The second part, though, was the other layer. The other layer is the past, and so this film was built structurally in the editing room, right? So yes, we had present day observational filmmaking. We were you know following him in the moment. But the challenge was how to use that material in the editing room to build a sort of constructed narrative, because we didn't have a natural narrative arc in the story. This wasn't, you know, an A to Z type, you know, beginning, middle, end type story, and we had to build that in the editing room. So I worked with an amazing editor named Mike Munn. He's the editor of Stories We Tell. And in that film, of course, he brings to that movie this ability to, you know, cut between fiction and documentary in a way that's seamless, and that's exactly what I wanted to bring in a way to this movie, where you, it's not fiction and documentary. What I mean is from past to present. We have amazing access to archive in this film, where Robert was documented over the years in numerous different films, from when he was a young 20-year-old in covering Belfast, Northern Ireland, a BBC documentary with him and his floppy long hair and big bifocal glasses. It kind of looks like Woody Allen a little bit. And then the Woody Allen now, I think, is maybe not a good reference point.
I just thought that I was cringing when
yeah,
you said it.
Yeah, sorry. Yeah.
That's okay. Truth in storytelling.
You know, just look-wise. I'm not, you know. And then so...
Paul Simon.
Yeah, they're
Garfunkel.
Yeah, maybe Garfunkel. Yeah, just that floppy long hair feel. So yeah, the challenge really. So in terms of my line, it was sort of like, how do I build the story in the editing room, and you know, work with the interviews I had done with Robert, and try to kind of build an essay that is a conversation about journalism. For me. Just, you know, if the question is like, what was it like, you know, maintaining the observational storyline with him and not get sucked into, never questioning things. I mean, I think it was always that approach. I was questioning him, and as we were working along it with him. But I think also, I think the idea of using observational filmmaking allows hopefully the space for the audience to sort of think about it. I'm not gonna make it too obvious, I think. and I think it's similar with Up the Yangtze and China Heavyweight and even Fruit Hunters, there is a subjective point of view in terms of like, I'm making a film about Robert Fisk. Yeah. You know, he has something to say, maybe. Let's see if we can listen and agree or disagree. But that also, there seems to be a closer line between documentary film and maybe Robert Fisk's approach to journalism. Sure. This idea that that we are to report on the side of those who suffer. Mm-hmm. I mean, my filmmaking certainly looks at that, approaches subjects and the people I follow mm-hmm. through that kind of point of view. Mm-hmm. And there was a filmmaker, Laura Poitras, who made Citizen Four, about the Snowden story and cracked that story, essentially. She described journalism, documentary, not as pure journalism, but as documentary plus. It's what she says. It's fact, really strong fact checking, and storytelling, and creative storytelling, and for me, that's also really integral to what I bring as a filmmaker to make a movie cinematic and engaging in a way that is, like, kind of, you know, it's not 60 minutes. You know what I mean? We're trying to do something a little different for the audience.
Do you think that journalism and the news machine has adopted storytelling and filmmaking in order to hold people's attention, whether it's in an entertaining way or just to keep people literally held on for those minutes? Hmm. Do you think they've adopted the storytelling too far?
Oh.
Hence it becoming fake news.
What are you thinking about?
Sensational. Some of the networks,
CNN.
I don't want to name a network, but whether they lean one way politically or the other, journalists hopefully have that desire to have their integrity there. But just the same way that Robert experienced censorship, mm-hmm. a little bit of too much control coming from above his editors, and disappointment in his editors for not helping stay true to the story he needed to tell. Mm-hmm. Do you think that journalists and programs which have to satisfy ad buys and ad sales are adopting things to be,
I see what you mean,
be really, you know, and crafted and edited to really be sensational, even though you could fact check them? But when does the job become entertaining and holding an audience versus reporting from a front line, what's actually going on? I mean, and I think it's maybe just such a huge debate that seeing this just gets right into the front lines of what that level of journalism does. I don't even know what we're talking about.
No, I think your questions are very, very appropriate and maybe kind of coming out of the movie. You know, I do think that's the kind of provocation we present. I think. I know, I'm not a journalist, so I can't speak on how, but I can, as an observer of the news, and I read the news, so where do I go when I read the news? You know, I still, you know, tap into mainstream media sources, like I do look at the New York Times, and even though, you know, they have a complicated sort of, they're not perfect either, is what I mean, but I do read their work. I read the New Yorker magazine, which I think is great long-form storytelling and journalism. And I look at alternative news sites like The Intercept, like Democracy Now, because that's where my politics lie. I'm not gonna watch Fox News. I'm not gonna read Breitbart News, you know, like, what is that, Breitbart? Yeah. I mean, it's just not where I go. So, I think there is a responsibility to report the news in a engaging way that, like Robert does. And I think, as he talks about in the movie, he is a storyteller. He's trying to write to people like as if he's sitting there and telling them a story. You know what I mean? And I think that's important. That connects people emotionally to something. If you're reporting something very dry, in a dry-like way, and it comes across, you know, like statistical or just not, you know, like. Similarly, I mean, a great example is Up the Yangtze. And Up the Yangtze is a film, not that I mean it's a great film, but what I mean, no, no,
it's
I mean,
you know. It's a great Canadian film. It's an award-winning great Canadian film.
I'll take all that. I'll take all that. But what I mean is that when I learned about the Three Gorges Dam and all I could see it as, especially the way it was worded in the West, was statistics, you know, largest dam in the world, million people being moved. And, you know, you had all the facts. But there was no emotional connection to it. It sounded, you know, like a travesty. But what was really going on? And that's why I, similar to what I think what Robert does, is I moved to Chongqing, and I lived there, and I worked with a Chinese crew, and I lived with the subjects of the film, and I you know, made a story following them around that, and hopefully that is the intention, was to connect that big picture, you know, statistical story to the more human emotional side of things. So I think that's the goal of journalism, especially maybe this sort of journalism, is to make it vivid, make it real, make it emotional. I think Robert writes in a way that is, if you read his work, his long form work, like his book, The Great War for Civilization, or Pity the Nation, these are big tomes, and they're wonderfully written. They're detailed, they're personal, but there's a sort of Hemingway-esque sort of, you know,
Hemingway.
There's a sort of like simplicity to the writing that, because it's kind of pared down and sparingly used, his words, his sentences, they in fact become more emotional.
Well, his sentences are so punctuated and potent. In their
distilled down to essential.
Oh my goodness!
You know,
and they really evoke a time where it wasn't so instant. You couldn't stream and see what was going on.
Yeah.
There had to be enough to evoke all the senses when reading it.
Mm-hmm. Totally.
But from not being emotional, from being distant from it, and just being.
Yeah. And by default, I think that unemotional approach then makes it. What I argue is that it actually becomes very. Very emotional, you know, when he describes, you know, witnessing in Iraq, was it Iraq, where he saw the hanging of men hanging from, you know, hanged in the village, and how it was so horrifying that he couldn't even write the words to describe it. He drew it in his notebook, and then he went back to then write based on the images in the notebook, but he describes that very encounter, and by that it becomes horrifying.
It almost reminded me, the bits that you showed where he's reciting some of his or reading back some of his work reminded me a little bit of the old World War I and World War II poets who would write their poetry from the front lines, not necessarily intending to be poetic, but their feelings, which have turned into sort of lasting imprints.
Yeah, that's right.
But you know, he's been in these war-ravaged countries, not unlike a soldier, reporting back, and yet having to distance himself from being completely overcome by it.
And just to add to that, I think that something that comes out about his character is a certain sense of his levity. You know, like, he's sort of a special guy that can, like, be very humorous. He's quite... You know, he can be quite satirical and funny and charming and, you know, light.
Yeah.
And that levity, I think, speaks to why he's been able to live through 40 years of war and outlive, you know, other journalists and be able to still live in the Middle East and report on the side of those who suffer.
Very unapologetically, but beautifully unapologetically. Mm-hmm. He's just sticking to his own lane and his own path and not necessarily out to change anyone's mind, but he's not going to stray from his own.
Yeah, and as he says in the movie, like, I'm here to do the work, just do the work, and ignore all the noise and the controversy that he may drum up, but just do the work.
So,
thanks for holding the mic.
So, I want to speak about your journey now as a Canadian filmmaker, as a documentarian.
Mm-hmm.
We have a lot of emerging filmmakers and, not just emerging filmmakers, and audiences, and students, people who are curious about filmmaking and what it takes to do what you do and how to do what you do. So I have this quote from Robert Fisk, and it says, if you don't go to the scene and sniff it and see it with your own eyes, you can't get near to what the truth is. So that comes across so powerfully that you did that. You did exactly that to get on that side with Robert. Tell us about your journey now as a filmmaker, getting the support from the National Film Board and the producers who would really get behind your desire to go to that front line.
Well, yeah, no, I think the process of filmmaking is not, for me, it's not in a silo. I'm not operating as a lone wolf making my films. It's certainly a process of collaboration. So from the get-go, it's like, you know, getting the call from Anita Lee, producer at the National Film Board of Canada, and Nella Frapezira, who said, are you interested in making a film about Robert Fisk? Of course I was, because I was familiar with some of his work from the past. And then finding that, building that team to include Alison Luchak and Ingmar Trost, and as a result, you know, then they go out and build the financing for the film, for which, you know, you want to be able to work with a little bit more flexibility. You need money to make a film. And in this day and age, you do it through co-productions, which this was a co-production with Germany and with Ingmar Trost. From his company is called Sudor Kolonko. And he's based in Cologne, Germany. And he can tap into this media fund and regional media fund that just was wonderful. He tapped into the broadcaster to ZDF Arte, who's German France, and then, you know, we had the support of NFB, the Telefilm Canada, of course, Ontario Creates, Blue Ice Docs became the distributor. You know, we had the British organization Doc Society, who came in to help support us. You know, all of that legitimizes the project, and it also helps to just give us the funding to be able to make the film we want to make, you know. Yeah.
Now, did you find that during that process, because he's so controversial, because there are so many different perhaps point of views or perspectives that one might take away from this film, was there fear at all from people that by showing this they might lose support from their funders or from their... Yeah, how far did that trickle in whatsoever?
Yeah, you know, what's amazing about Canada, let me just say briefly, in Canada we have the support of these funding agencies and these institutions like the National Film Board of Canada, who are willing to kind of take risks and allow a filmmaker to make a film about a subject who may be considered slightly controversial or divisive or whatever. But that they'll stand behind that and give us the funding and the resources to be able to do that. I mean, there's, I think, very few organizations in the world that, except maybe, you know, I would say maybe Denmark and Canada and wherever else, but Canada especially, I'd like to say, is remarkable. Like, where do you find that? And so, yeah, I think we didn't encounter any kind of pushback. It was a film about Robert Fisk, and I think people are interested in that, and especially see the relevance in today's world, where we are in a integral, you know, moment of questioning what the media scape is, and what media literacy is.